Everyone loves to hear a good secret, right? Well, we've got seven for you today, and Alex Paradise is here with me, and we've got kind of a special treat. You are going to provide our Seven Secrets Root Cause Analysis webinar for everyone.
Yep.
And let's just get started.
Yeah, let's jump into it.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Seven Secrets of Root Cause Analysis webinar by Taproot. I'm Alex Paradise. I'm going to be walking you through this webinar today. Just a note, there is going to be some information that is shared in this that is protected by U.S. copyright laws, so do not distribute or repurpose anything you see in this presentation without express permission from System Improvements and Taproot. If you want to get copies of this presentation or have this webinar done for your facilities, go ahead. You can reach out and contact me at alexparadise@taproot.com or alex@taproot. Or you can go ahead and message info@taproot. You can get some information on this webinar. So just email info@taproot.com if you want to get your own copy of this webinar or have this webinar performed for your team or people. A little bit of a background on System Improvements. Those who don't know, we've been leading root cause analysis investigators and teaching Taproot techniques for over 30 years. Our system was developed back in the 80s, and really when our founders set out to create the Taproot system, they were really looking at the state of root cause analysis at that time and realized people weren't applying the human performance best practices and expertises that existed. So our fundamental mission became changing the way the world solves problems and, you know, providing people with the information and tools in order to do a really thorough investigation. And what we're going to be talking about today are seven of the secrets that we've learned over those 30 years for how to perform exceptional investigations and how to dive down in incident investigations and find root cause. So we're going to be covering these seven secrets of root cause analysis. And we're going to start right off the bat with secret one. Your root cause analysis is only as good as the info you collect. Essentially, garbage in equals garbage out. If you're not collecting the right kinds of information and you're not organizing information correctly and you're not getting and digging in and getting the right information, you're not going to have a good investigation. Now, you can see in this short little video we showed you here, a person had a car accident. They were falling asleep at the wheel. They fell asleep, drifted off the road, and crashed the vehicle. Now, a question you might want to ask is, what kinds of information would you expect to get in an investigation like this? If we did not have a dash cam and you interviewed this person, and what kinds of things would they tell you? Would you hear that there was something in the road, that I had to dodge it and I fell off the road? Would you hear that there was some extensive circumstance that you couldn't hear or didn't know about? If you didn't have that objective evidence of a dash cam looking at this person's face, watching them fall asleep as they went off the road, do you think you'd be able to get the information necessary to understand the mistakes that were made in an incident? And that's something that's really critical. And that's why we say the first thing is you've got to get your facts straight and you've got to get the right information and gather the right evidence. And this is why things like video recordings and objective evidence are extremely important in investigations. Secret number two, you must understand what happened before you can understand why it happened. Now, in Taproot, we focus on the what first in our planning and investigation phase. We start by gathering the information, understanding where we need to investigate, planning out who do we need to speak to, where do we need to go, and building out our snap chart, which is a timeline of events. before we start answering why, before we start identifying those mistakes, errors, and failures, before we start getting to root cause and developing corrective actions, we really want to look for the what before we start asking why. So here's another video example, and I want you to focus on that red box. You see those guys at that ladder at that red box? That's what I want you guys to watch in this video here. You'll notice the first man climbing up the ladder, and you'll see a second man below that. And he's holding some sort of blueprints in his hand, and he begins to climb the ladder. Now, when he's climbing the ladder, you can see he's only using one hand to climb, and he slips. He lands on that second platform, and he falls all the way to the ground. And these two other gentlemen run over, and they yank him up by his arms. Now, if we pause this video right here, and we looked around at the environment, and we kind of take a snapshot of what was going on, you would notice that the guy was wearing, he had fall protection harness on, but it wasn't clipped to anything. In fact, no one in the shot that's wearing fall protection is clipped to anything. You'll also notice there's no mid-rail on that platform. And you'll have noticed when he fell, his arms were out in the fencing response. So there's some information. We've got a lot of information we can go off of and determine from just from watching this video. But before you start answering why, you need to understand the what, and you need to organize the what. And so this is where we teach the techniques for gathering information, interviews, physical evidence, process data. You've got to gather that information, and you need to organize it, because you know, the last thing you really need in an investigation is paragraphs and paragraphs and paragraphs of information that it gives you details, but it's impossible to decipher and read through. So what we in Taproot talk about is we talk about putting things in an easy to understand flow chart of information, which we call the snap chart. So this would be the snap chart of that scenario we just watched. And from here, you can see that timeline of events from the worker climbing the ladder, reaching for that rung, his hand missing the rung, then falling from the ladder, landing on the platform, falling backward off that platform, dropping approximately 14 feet to the ground and hitting the pavement. So you can see that timeline of what happened, and you can see the details that support under there. Things like the worker is only using one hand to climb. Worker does not have doesn't have any device to carry blueprints with him. He's actually holding the blueprints in his hand. He's not wearing any fall protection. Fall protection was provided, but there's no policy for using fall protection when climbing a ladder. There's only 3 points of contact required by company policy. You might have information about there's no mid-rail, that a mid-rail is required by OSHA requirements, and then that the person fell between the mid-rail and the platform, fell 14 feet. You've got facts and information that help describe that. You might want to know about the worker's training. Did they know what the fencing response looks like? I think most of us in the safety industry understand when you see the fencing response, the last thing you want to do is yank the guy up by his arms. We all know that fencing response is an indication of potential for traumatic brain injury, spinal damage, things like that. That person is in a concussed state. We want to leave them on the ground and wait for medical to get there and evaluate the person before lifting them up and moving them, because they could potentially have some damage and we could be making it worse by yanking the guy up. So there's a lot of information that exists there, and you have to organize this and understand it before you start identifying those mistakes, errors, and failures. The person missing that rung and only using one hand to climb, there not being a mid-rail on the platform, or the worker not wearing any fall protection. There's different mistakes that occurred, just like those guys lifting that worker up by their arms. And you need to have a complete picture before you start selecting these things. Because if you start with the why, you might just only focus in on the fact that he was climbing with one hand. You might not think about, well, why didn't we have a mid-rail? Why don't we require fall protection when climbing ladders? Why did these guys yank him up by the hands? Why did they yank him up after this injury? We might miss these other opportunities for improvement and for bettering our system if we're not focusing on the why, on the what, before the why. Secret number three, your lack of knowledge, your knowledge or lack of it can get in the way of good root cause analysis. Obvious, right? If I don't have knowledge, if I don't know things, how on earth can I do root cause analysis? Well, there's a lot of cause and effect assumptions that go into root cause and analysis. There's a lot of techniques that are taught. Fault trees, fishbone diagrams, five whys. All of these techniques are about organizing the what you know into different formats to help break down information. You've got to know the cause and effect relationships to find out the root cause. I've got to be an expert in the way things fail in order to understand what happened. So your root cause analysis is limited by your current knowledge. So when you're using these kind of cause and effect maps, if you're not an expert, you're never going to get down to root cause because you're not going to know the questions you need to ask in order to get down to root cause. You're going to stay very surface level. This leads to two kinds of traps. The first is the inexperienced investigator trap. You don't know all the potential causes. You might only know one. This came up with me a lot when I was a manager. I had brand new supervisors. I had four supervisors of an area, and out of those four supervisors, only three of them had prior experience in that department. They were experienced guys in different areas of the facility, but they didn't have experience with my department. And what I found is in their investigations, when they were digging down to root cause, they didn't ask enough questions. They would stop at surface level things and not question enough. They would take a lot of information at face value and didn't dig further because they didn't know what there was, what things they needed to ask and what further areas they needed to investigate. So they were only maybe finding one cause. And they stopped. They didn't dig more. They didn't look at the whole process. The second trap is the experienced investigator trap. So your new people may not know the questions to ask, and your experienced investigators may be biased, to favorite causes, and they might not have any psychology or human factors knowledge. So you might have really experienced investigators that are really good at understanding the system failures, but they don't understand the human factors side of it, the human factors knowledge and human performance expertise knowledge in order to look at certain areas. So an example of this, you know, if you've been in maintenance for 30 years and you find an incident that has some sort of failed equipment pump or failed, I can go look at these maintenance logs, I can decipher this information and go find where the mechanic or where the maintenance man wasn't doing what he needed to do in order to make this machine work the way it was supposed to. But I may not be looking at different areas. I may not have experience in training, quality controls. I don't know anything about procedure writing, perhaps. So you might have favorite causes. I might know a lot about the most effective ways to direct workers and give them effective job briefings and make sure they're prepared for their job. But I may not know how to write a really good procedure. I may not know how to perform effective three-way communication. So you may have very limited knowledge. You might be an expert from years of experience in this process and be very strong on the process, but you have very limited knowledge in this whole breadth of human factors or psychology that you might be missing. So both of these traps lead to missed opportunities because you're not asking more the in-depth questions necessary to dig deeper into problems. So this is where Taproot's a little bit different and what we kind of focus on. So we focus on the what first, then we get into the why. And when we get into the why, we're actually taking those mistakes, errors, and failures through the root cause tree. And we're looking for missing best practices. Now, there are seven basic cause categories in Taproot. There's training, procedures, quality controls, communications, management systems, human engineering, and work direction. And just one of these categories I'm showing you here is human engineering. And from this category, we're looking for things that you can fix in our system. We're looking for root causes as things you can fix, things like labels that need improvement, arrangement, placement of materials. Were the people monitoring too many items? Was there an issue with the work environment? So we have all these different criteria that we help guide you through the process of investigating and finding. Because our goal, when we define root cause analysis, it's the absence of a best practice or the failure to apply knowledge that would have prevented the problem. or significantly reduce the likelihood or consequences. So by searching for those missing best practices, the goal of root cause analysis becomes finding the things we can implement to improve our system and prevent reoccurrence. It gets you away from the blame game. It gets you away from simple cause and effect, and focus more on how do you improve human performance. So we do this in Taproot by asking simple yes or no questions. And we've got a lot of them that help guide investigators. There's 15 questions that help you get into the categories, and there's questions that help guide you down to specific root causes. And some of these questions are pretty obvious. This is one of our root causes here, labels need improvements. And the first question is pretty obvious, you know, are labels or warning signs missing? You know, that's a pretty obvious thing. If we didn't have a warning sign or a label and somebody pushed the wrong button that caused an incident, you know, a simple thing is to provide a label so that they know what they are supposed to push and what they're not supposed to. If somebody exited out the wrong door and ended up getting injured because that door, they thought it was an emergency exit and it was really a confined space entry and it wasn't properly labeled, and there they entered in and got into a problem, you know, those things make a difference. So if you don't have a label, you should have one. But we get a little bit more specific. Would a better label or warning sign? Perhaps this sign wasn't, you had a sign, it was really small and you couldn't see it. Perhaps it was hard to read. Maybe there was dirt smeared and things that obstructed the label, or perhaps it was unclear and ambiguous. We had a scenario in my facility where we had maintenance had put in a filter in one of our machines, and we noticed after about a few days that we were having quality problems out of that machine. And when we went back and were plotting out and trying to troubleshoot and figure out what happened, we looked back at the maintenance and we said, you know, we went through this maintenance, what did you guys change out? Well, we changed this filter. Well, let's go look at what filter you put in there. So we pull out the filter, and indeed they had put the wrong filter in. And we looked to why they put the wrong filter in, and we went back and did some investigations. What we found was there were two nearly identical filters. They looked almost the same. The boxes were the same, same company. The names were almost the same. The only difference between the two labels, one of them, there's a 14-digit number, and in the very middle of it was a B. And the other one, in the very middle of it, was a D. And the maintenance guy that went back to go get the filter, he just saw the 5 at the end and grabbed that one and didn't see the difference between the two. So you can see the label itself contributed and led to, the poor label led to the person making the mistake. And so you want to look at those things, and we want to guide people down to these. So we help guide you through that process with an expert system. And you might ask, well, where do we come up with these categories? Where do we come up with these root causes? Well, every one of these root causes in the Taproot process comes from decades of human factors experience and engineering experience. Every one of our root causes is backed by research. It's backed by experience, not just our experiences, but our thousands of Taproot users and our 60 company advisory boards. We evaluate our system to see what we're missing, what we need to adjust, what questions need to be tweaked. Secret number 4, interviews are not about asking questions. I know what you're thinking. If they're not about asking questions, what are they about? Well, interviews should be about stimulating memories and collecting the best possible information. It's not about how good of questions you ask. It's about how much you can get the person to speak and how much information you can get them to tell you. So one of the things we do in Taproot is we teach some cognitive memory techniques. The very first one is stop interrupting people. It's the most simple thing. When you're gathering information and when you're interviewing somebody, the most effective thing you can do is have them start at the beginning, in their own words, tell you what happened, start to finish, and don't interrupt them. Because when you interrupt somebody that's in the middle of telling you a story, you are breaking their memory chain. You're breaking that chain of events. Because when you're recalling things, it's like you're walking down a path in your mind. And when you're recalling things, you're thinking back and you're looking back, and you're walking that path. And when somebody stops you in the middle and asks you a question, might be a relevant question, mind you, but when they ask you the question, you're stopped, you're coming back to reality, and you have to find where you were in your brain again in that pathway. And so by interrupting people, you're interrupting that flow of memory, and that makes it where people have far less detail that they end up giving you. So one of the best things you can do at the beginning is let them start at the beginning and go start to finish. Now, we cover a lot more about this technique in our 5-day training course and in our free webinar. We've got a webinar that you can attend. We also have a self-guided course that you can attend on interviewing and evidence collection, and we cover a lot of that. But the main thing to lean on here is stop interrupting people when you're gathering and interviewing people. Let them speak, let them get to the end. Then you can ask some clarifying questions. You can have them revisit some things, but let them go start to finish without interruption. Secret number 5. You can't solve all human performance problems with discipline, procedures, and training. Now, I know a lot of people, every course I've ever taught, I ask people, what are the most common? And they always come up with discipline, training, and procedures again and again and again. And we always ask them, you know, if it didn't work the first time when we disciplined, retrained, and we wrote a longer procedure, why do we think it's going to work this time? These are the standard 3. They're inside the box. They're the defaults that everybody goes to. And so what we want to focus people on is not just doing the same 3 things again and again and again and expecting different results. That's the definition of insanity. We want to give a tool to break you out of those and dig deeper. Now, the first things we teach, and we teach this in the 5-day course, is smarter corrective actions. Now, I'm sure you guys have all heard smart corrective actions. We have 2 more that talk about making sure we're verifying or that it's effective and we're reviewing the process with management. We cover that technique in our 5-day course a lot more. We also cover the hierarchy of safeguards. This comes out of a lot of that prior stuff with Swiss cheese analysis and old school control of processes. But when you're thinking about a problem, you need to do the most effective kinds of corrective actions. And the most effective things you can do are remove and reduce the hazard. And the least effective things you can do are things like discipline, training, and procedures. Because discipline, training, and procedures don't really prevent reoccurrence. They're really just trying to make humans more reliable safeguards, when in reality, you need to be focusing on elimination of those hazards. And if you can't eliminate those hazards, how can you remove the target from being around those hazards? And if you can't do that, how do you guard the target? How do you improve human performance through good human factor design? How do you design a system that is less likely to fail given that people are working in it? And if you can't do that, how do you organize information? And if you can't do that, how do you train people to be aware of those problems and not make those mistakes? Secret number 6. How is often people can't even imagine effective corrective actions, even if they find the root, often people can't imagine effective corrective actions, even if they find the problem's root cause. So this is actually a case that did come up from one of our courses. This was one of the early courses that was taught back in the 90s, the early 5-day. And it was before we had the corrective action helper. We were teaching, and one of our examples, you find a root cause of labels need improvement. And then we work with the person on coming up with corrective actions. And this is an actual corrective action proposed by a person. So the actual corrective action proposed was to tell people to be careful when operating equipment that isn't labeled. And it was at that moment we realized, you know, people need help coming up with corrective action. Sometimes you can find the problem, you know, didn't have a label. So you'd think the easy, obvious solution, add a label. Nope, we're going to tell people to be careful when operating things without a label. No, that's not a good corrective action. So we realized we needed to provide some guidance. So what we did for every single root cause, for every single near root cause category and basic cause category in the Taproot system, there is a corrective action helper guide section on that. There's a whole section. It looks at a check. It gives you guidance on how to evaluate that issue, how to look for generic causes that might be allowing this issue to be a problem, not just in this area, but in other areas. And there's also references and guides that to reference to other outside standards that you can reference to develop better corrective actions. So it helps come up with both better short-term and long-term measures for effectiveness. And we provide this in our software as well as a paper-based copy that you get when you come to Taproot Training. And it's things like for labeling. This is our corrective action section for labels need improvement. What we talked about earlier, we didn't have a label on something. It always starts out with that most obvious, you know, ideas for improvement. You should consider recommending improving labeling. You'd think that's too obvious. Nobody needs that guidance. And yet, remember that previous example, people need to think about this. First, improve the label. But it gets better than that. We talk about making things easy to recognize and see, perhaps making it a different color that stands out from the background. If I've got five pipes that I need to identify, a different color helps me identify those pipes in that background. It also, again, like I said, looks for generic causes and provides references and standards. If I need help on designing a better label, maybe I want to go look at the Nuclear Engineering Regulation 0700, you know, and look at how in the nuclear industry how they build the most effective labels. Secret number 7. All investigations do not need to be created equal, but some investigation steps should never be skipped. This is kind of a question that we always want you guys to think about, is should every investigation be a major production? Do I need a cross-functional team on every investigation? Do I need to be reporting up all the way to the VP for every accident? Or is there some stuff that needs a simplified methodology? And I think the answer is obviously no, not every investigation should be a big production. So this is why in Taproot we give you two different investigation options. We have the 7-step major investigation process for those higher risk, major impact investigations. And then we have the Taproot Essentials process, which is our low to medium risk, less complex process. Now, there's still the same fundamentals. You're understanding the what, then you're understanding the why, and you're coming up with corrective actions. That's still going to exist in that lower, that essentials technique. But we also have a nothing more to learn category, because there are times when you're going to gather information and realize the likelihood of this occurring is so low and the consequences were so low, it is not worth our resources time to spend and develop corrective actions for. There is only so much time your investigators have in a week, in a day, in a year, and you really should be thinking about, yes, it's worth collecting evidence on a paper cut, on a finger cut, on a first aid incident. It's worth collecting some details and getting some information on that, but is it worth spending a trained investigator's time to dig into things that have a very low consequence or low probability of reoccurrence? If somebody's walking in our parking lot and it's flat level, there's nothing, no cause for issue, and they fall for what appears to be no reason other than perhaps they tripped on their shoe or something and they twist their ankle. That's a pretty low thing, though we've all, you know, it doesn't happen very often, though we've all had probably something like that occur in a facility. But is it really worth redesigning our entire parking lot for? Probably not. But it is worth collecting information and making sure that there's not something missing. We want to make sure that we're not missing, hey, the parking lots have been out for 6 weeks and nobody's reported it, nobody's fixed it. Or, hey, you know, we had ice and we didn't follow our icing procedure where we didn't salt the ground before the heavy ice and freeze. You know, we want to make sure that we didn't make any of those kind of mistakes. We want to gather that evidence, but we don't want to spend time digging about root cause and digging at corrective actions when it's not necessary. That's why in Taproot, we just focus on the essentials, finding out your snap chart, finding those mistakes, errors, and failures that led to the incident, then taking those mistakes and finding the root cause, taking them through to the corrective action helper, and finding those innovative solutions to fix those root causes. That's the essentials technique, and we do that whether it's a low, medium risk or the high risk, but we want to really evaluate, is this worth our investigators' time to go further than just gathering the facts? Now, this is the portion I kind of talk a little bit more about Taproot. if you haven't gathered from this, Taproot is really focused on understanding why people make mistakes and why humans make the mistakes they do, and how do you build a system that prevents people from making mistakes. So you can apply our techniques in health and safety, in environmental issues, process safety, quality issues, customer complaints, security. It works anywhere that people are making mistakes in a system, and you want to understand what you can be doing to prevent those mistakes from reoccurring. Taproot is a great way to apply that in those techniques. There's lots of things I could tell you about return on investment, but I really want to tell you a story that makes a lot of difference to us at Taproot. Every year we have our Taproot Summit. We have them every year. This year we're looking at doing a Taproot Summit in the summer. There's potential for those things to be online as well to share this out with people. But every year we do the summit, we gather all the people, we have a lot of people that have been trained, our experts, some of our instructors, as well as some of our super users, our clients that have been using Taproot for a very long time and want to learn more. We all come together and we work, we converse. And at that Taproot Summit, there was really an interesting story that came up, and it happened to our founder. This was one of the first summits that we did. And he was presenting, and at the end of the presentation, he got down and he was walking through the crowd, and one of the guys came up to him and he said, "You know, Mark, I just wanted to shake your hand and I wanted to thank you on behalf of our company and really on behalf of every company that's here. And I just want to say thank you." And Mark was kind of taken aback, said, "Okay, you're welcome. What exactly for?" And he said, "Well, you know, at my facility, we don't have fatalities anymore." And Mark's kind of taken aback and he said, "Tell me more." And the guy said, "Well, you know, we used to have one fatality about every 18 months at our facility. And since we started using Taproot and started applying it proactively, we don't have fatalities anymore. And we've been using Taproot for about 4 years. And the way I figure it is, that's 4 people that have been able to go home to their families. And that's, 16 or so people's lives that have been, affected because their spouse came home or their brother came home or their son came home, and we just wanted to thank you on behalf of our company for that." And the guy went on to say, looking around the room, there's hundreds of companies here. And when I think about it, there's hundreds of lives that have gone home to their families. There's hundreds of husbands and wives and sons and daughters and brothers and sisters that are now back with their family that might not have been if these people weren't using Taproot. And I just wanted to thank you for that." And that was one of the first moments that it kind of hit us at about the effect that we really have on a company. It's not just dollars. It's not about reducing lost time or workers' comp claims. It's not about increased reliability or regulatory turnaround. All of those things are great for the company. And they're great for those, our clients that implement those. But at the end of the day, for us, the most important thing is that because of our technique and because of what we're teaching people and because of the way it's being applied in companies, people are going home to their families. And that makes the biggest difference to us. And so that's really what I want to share with you, not about the way you can get ROI, but that the effects of good root cause analysis is not about good ROI, but it's about people going home to their wife and kids. And that's the most important thing to us. And that's why we kind of consider a partnership with our clients. We're not just trying to sell training. We're not just trying to sell a product. We sell a partnership with our clients. We work through a roadmap to success from understanding what are your clients' needs, what are our partners focused on achieving in their organization, who do we need to focus on, how do we gain management acceptance, how do we gain compliance, how do we get the most value, and how do we do that over the long haul? We work with our clients to develop out a plan that goes from the beginning of a process of understanding needs all the way through to continuous improvement a decade down the road. So that's kind of some other things, and I want to give you a little bit of the Taproot advantages. Again, we're an expert system that provides a structured guidance for your investigators. It's going to be based off of extensive human performance expertise, which that means even your inexperienced investigators are going to be able to ask the same questions and get the same answers as a trained human performance expert. This leads to consistent investigation results and trendable data. Because we have a categorized list, you're going to be able to trend the information that you get from root cause analysis. We also have a proven process that removes investigator bias. We're forcing people to ask questions they've never asked before and look at areas that they've never looked at before. And with that, all of our investigators, you know, that use Taproot get a comprehensive set of human performance expert investigator questions. We're going to be looking at things like fatigue. We're going to be looking at things like work direction, communication styles, training objectives, human-machine interfaces, knowledge-based systems. This really helps people look deeper into processes they may not be familiar with. And finally, once you know the root cause, we're going to be helping you find innovative and better corrective actions using the corrective action helper and the hierarchy of safeguards. And Taproot's really good because you have these questions, you have these human performance best practices, which means not only is it a reactive tool for when accidents occur, but it can be a proactive tool to help prevent reoccurrence and help prevent an accident before it happens. We can audit and make sure our systems have the robust best practices that are out there. We also offer software. This integrates with Intellex, Enablon, Cordy. There's others on the way because we have an open API that can connect with your systems and share information. We also offer on-site implementation of software, as well as connection to your active user directory. We also have a Taproot app. You can go to iTunes, download that Taproot app right now. It's on Apple, iOS, and Android devices. And you can use that to help gather information and connect it right into your software and information right out of the field into there. We also provide report customization that fits your industry's needs, whether you've got a report to government agencies, you've got to report findings, or maybe you guys have specific details of things you want to record and record. Our software is customizable and our reports are fully customizable as well. As well as we offer built-in investigation grading and coaching modules, as well as trending, so you can track and trend your incidents to make sure you're understanding what kinds of problems are propping up in what areas. It is a cloud-based solution, and we offer hosting where we'll host the data for you, or you guys can host the data on your servers. If you want more information about that, you can reach out to me or at alex@taproot.com, or you can reach out to info@taproot. So if you're looking to get an executive briefing or learn more, maybe a software demo, feel free to email myself or to go to info@taproot.com for more information. So with that, I want to thank you guys for sticking through the whole presentation. I hope you like, comment, subscribe. If you've got questions, again, feel free to reach out to me. And we'll see you later at another Taproot TV episode. Bye.